Do you think that this can kill you? Do you really think that this can kill you? I'll tell you what can kill you. Culture shock can kill you. Culture shock can kill you. I would like to tell you the story. Let's start with the story. I'd like to tell you the story, and afterwards we'll get more serious. So imagine. Just imagine that you get up in the morning as the chief security officer of a major government authority, and by noontime you find yourself promoted to the high rank of manager of a refugee camp. That's a real refugee camp. No office, no secretaries, no plasma screens, no coffee machines. Only rolling hills with grass and thousands upon thousands upon thousands of displaced persons. Men, women, children, and babies. Now that's my definition for a bloody culture shock. It was July the 15th, 2006, the day after the outbreak of the Second Lebanese War. Thousands of missiles fired by Hezbollah descended on our northern cities. Critical services were denied. Critical structures were destroyed. Tens of thousands of people were compelled to leave their homes. Now, the $1 million question was, what do you do? Thanks, sir. What do you do with tens of thousands of displaced persons in the middle of the Mediterranean summer? Now, it's a very simple question. What people do in their summer vacations? They go camping, isn't it? So let's have them camping, open the national parks, and make them comfortable, just fine. Perfect. Perhaps in the air-conditioned rooms of the conference room of the government, this idea had a ring, a certain ring of sanity to it. But as we know, no plan survives its first meeting with the enemy or with the reality. So here I found myself in the middle of the summer with babies crying for milk, with teenagers screaming for Wi-Fi, with mothers complaining about the facilities, and with mothers complaining about the families, obviously. Okay. Old army tents waiting to be erected, mountains of mattresses to be distributed, long lines of trucks with supplies to be unloaded, and complaints, and even more complaints, and the whiff of mutiny in the air. Suddenly, as if I imagine, an old school has arrived, and girl soldiers with miniskirts descended from the bus. Their commander, another uniformed teenager, climbed up on the top of the bus, took out the loudspeaker, and told them, "Hey folks, welcome to my summer camp, let's party." Suddenly, there was music. And the girl soldiers opened boxes with ice cream for the children. And then they put up funny hats and put up a dance show for the children. Now the kids were completely transfixed. They looked completely transfixed at the girl soldiers. The fathers looked completely transfixed at the miniskirts. And the mothers looked completely annoyed at the fathers. Okay. So, and slowly, God Almighty's peace descended on the camp. Okay, suddenly the refugee camp became a camp of the summer camp. Okay, the ordeal turned into a vacation. And from this point on, the management of all this flying circus became a piece of cake. Now, up to here is the story. Okay, what's the moral of this story? What's the moral? That afternoon, on those hot rolling hills, I have seen a cold truism manifesting itself in real life. A truism which is easy to forget despite its obvious banality. Objective measures of danger, harm, and loss are much less important than the way we perceive them and we react to them. Okay, as long as humans destroy the earth, perception will count more than reality. Okay. Now, how this is connected to critical infrastructures. Ladies and gentlemen, the purpose of my lecture is to share with you some of my thoughts regarding perception and reality, about the psychological or moral and the physical, and all this in the context of critical infrastructure protection. Okay, then we have some water. It's not important for us, for us, middle distance here. I will start by presenting the problem, and I will try to demonstrate that it's a clear and real one. Then I will try to offer some kind of solution, perhaps at the beginning of a solution. So, first I would like to ask some basic questions about our profession. Why? Why do our adversaries attack our critical infrastructures? Why? What they wish to accomplish? What they wish to accomplish? Are they bent on destroying every single dam, every single power plant, every single pipe? Do they want to crush every hub, every switch, and every router? This is what they want to accomplish? No, obviously not. They hit only a few of our most critical infrastructures, all the while aiming at what? At our hearts and our minds, at our psyche and our morale, at our personal, city, municipal morale, and national morale. This is their real type, basically. Talking in terms of effect-based operations, they measure the effect of their actions not at the level of the infrastructure, but at a much, much deeper level, the level of our psyche. This is the real type. Now, I would like to ask my second question. Why do we seek to protect our critical infrastructures? Why? In order to be able to look at cat videos on YouTube, in order to have some cold beer in the summer? Why are we so scared of losing these creature comforts? Why? Now the answer, if we drill deep down enough, it's not technological at all. It's what we want, basically. We want to be content with our lives. Okay, so at the most simplest level, we want to be happy. And as we learned in our philosophy lessons, there is no point in asking further questions. We only want to be happy. Now, given this, if this is our main motivation, what are our most important critical infrastructures? The nuclear power plants, the content farms? No, our most critical infrastructures are the psychological, the moral ones. And these are the targets of our adversaries. Now, I would like to ask my last question. Okay, I've bothered you enough with my question. My last question. If what we are supposed to protect is not concrete, or steel, or silicon, but the human psyche, how many psychologists are in this room? Please, raise your hands. How many social sciences? Great. How many anthropologists? How many social workers? Now. If the critical infrastructure we seek to defend are not ends in themselves, but only intervening variables, why are we so fixated on them instead of an independent variable, the thing that we want to influence? Perhaps, we are like the proverbial drone that seeks the penny lost, not where he has lost it in the dark, but under the street light. Sorry for not having the presentation with a nice graphics of the drone, but we have to do without it. The argument I would like to make is that we in this profession suffer from a strange ailment of the eye. Okay, I call it technological tunnel vision. We suffer from a technological tunnel vision. We fix our gaze only on the effects of technology on technology, instead of looking sometimes at the effects of technology on real people. Okay. The argument I would like to make is it is not enough to claim expertise in the physical security and cybersecurity. We have to develop expertise in the nuts and bolts of the human soul, people's hearts and minds. As of today, when we think about the human factor, what the literature is about? It is about our adversaries. We always talk about our adversaries. What are the motivations? And what is the psychological profile of the lone wolf hacker? Okay, what disturbs us is an inside-out attack for you, the cyber jocks here, an inside-out attack by a disgruntled employee. Okay, or some social engineering exploits. This is the human factors that the literature is dealing about. We seldom give considerations about our side. Of the equation, our population, how the harm done to the physical infrastructure impacts our population. Now, I would like to offer a wide idea. Perhaps it is more cost-effective to increase the resilience, the psychological resilience of our population than to pour more concrete, hook up a few more cameras, or to harden our active directories. Okay, it is simply more simple. And if you think about this, society is becoming more and more complex. And this growing complexity, in order to supply the same level of security, we have to invest more and more. In economic terms, the return on investment, the return on security investment, gets down all the time. And if we take it, reductio ad absurdum, we take it to a very, very complex society, we will invest all of our money and we'll get zero security. Now, the only way to break this conundrum is to put more money on the psychology, in the psychological, on strengthening our psychological resilience and not the physical one. Now, I would like to give an example of how this works. Why the psychological is more, it's much, a much stronger than the physical in our profession. Using this Ilhan Omar's eternal line, in 2010, some people did something in Iran. Some centrifuge spun out of control. Such things happen from time to time. The ways of Allah are unfathomable. Now the question I would like to ask, what did the greatest harm, what was the greatest harm the Stuxnet war has done? What was the greatest harm? Destroying computers? Destroying a few SCADA controllers? Wasting a batch of uranium? The answer is no. The greatest harm by this cyber attack on Iran's nuclear infrastructure was mental and psychological. It compelled the Iranians to doubt everything and to suspect everything. The industrial equipment had to be tested, everything bought from the West. The chain of supply, the chain of logistics, the protocols, the code, the people, everything. Every gizmo connected had to be tested, retested, and after retesting it, it closed in technological prisons called Faraday cages. The cyber guys here know what I mean. Every line of code had to be taken apart, examined and re-examined, and not in virtual environments, in real environments, because we know that the Stuxnet worm function specifically in certain physical environments. And if you test on a virtual machine, you won't see anything. Now, in the final balance, the psychological harm done to Iran's press for the bomb was way higher than some broken Siemens centrifuges or some broken SCADA controllers. Way higher, for psychological. Now, there is another long-term trend that should focus or shift our gaze from the physical to the psychological. It's called terrorism. I looked up the University of Maryland's ADAS, the University of Maryland's terrorist database. And they look at 1 year only, but huge database. It's half a gigabyte of a chart. If you look at the distribution of the terrorist attacks, what do you think? What percentage of the terrorist attacks is focused against critical infrastructures? Do you have any idea? What percent of the terrorist attacks are targeting physical infrastructure? Four. F-O-R, 4%. Very few. Terrorists, I'm sorry for harming our business model here, but terrorists don't attack physical infrastructure. They are attacking symbols. Religious symbols, educational symbols, political symbols, as they top of the moral, not the physical. And as we know, conventional war is becoming much less frequent, and unconventional war is becoming much more frequent. So it must shift our gaze from this target to this target, and to have a target on this. Now, summing it up, we have established that both conventional adversaries and terrorists operate by generating debilitating psychological effects on their targets. Only that one side is doing it by destroying concrete, steel, and silicon, and the other side targeting directly our side. Now, the $1 million question is how to best defend against these threats. Basically, we have two ways. One is to harden and protect our physical infrastructure in the old method that we are all doing in our daily work. The other, the more subtle one, is to decrease the psychological fragility of the target population. To decrease the psychological fragility of the target population. This can be an organization, it can be a city, and it can be a nation. It can be a nation. How do you decrease fragility? By making people's morale more robust, more resilient, and more anti-fragile. Now, what are these terms? I'm indebted for these terms to Nassib Nicholas Taleb. Those who have read the Black Swan, anti-fragility, you know the guy is one of the great thinkers of our time. He talked about big things. What is robustness? Robustness refers to the ability to absorb a blow and not to fall, not to be knocked out. Resilience is the ability to bounce back, to absorb a blow and to bounce back and to get up again after getting this blow. And anti-fragility is to absorb successive blows and to get stronger and stronger after each successive blow. Just like our muscles, which grow with each exercise, this is the idea of anti-fragility. Now, how do we make our organizations, our cities, and our nations more robust, more resilient, and more anti-fragile? Now, that's a good, damn good question. I would like to offer you some ideas from my daily work in Israel's National Park Authorities. Basically, what we are talking about is a huge, decentralized organization sprawling over more than 100 facilities all over the country. Besides our core tasks, we receive more than 12 million visitors every year. It's very decentralized, it's very messy, it's very complex operation. Now, we know that given these circumstances, it's not a nuclear power plant. Given these circumstances, you cannot achieve a very high level of physical or cybersecurity. And our assumption is that our defenses will be breached. Okay, now, what are the compensating controls that we have installed? It is instead of strengthening the resilience of the physical infrastructure, we try to strengthen the resilience of the workforce, of our workers and our managers. Now, one way of achieving this is by ordering. Okay. In our experience, managers and workers who had working in different scenarios, both the plausible and the unplausible ones, react much more flexible way to the unexpected. Okay, we have developed our own methodology of wargaming. It's called layered wargaming. It's a pity that we don't have time to go into these methodological issues, but it's not the main topics of this conference. This is one way, wargaming. The other way is to borrow an idea of Comrade Seneca, Emperor Nero's mentor. What Seneca said, that if you are scared of losing your possessions, start each day by writing down everything you have and imagine that you don't have anything. You start the day with nothing on your back. Okay, nothing on your back. And we apply it in our world. For instance, we compel our workforce to work for half a day without internet. The work must go on, or just close the electricity, or compel them to move from one placement to the other in the middle of the workday. Okay, and in this way, we try to make them more resilient to these things that can happen. Now, as about anti-fragility, how you make your workforce and your personnel more anti-fragile? It is by cross-training, and enlarging their skill sets. The idea is to turn our people into human Swiss Army knives, to be able to use a ranger as a manager as a ranger, a logistics person and a ranger. Okay. Our experience is that people love to enlarge their skill sets and to exercise their new skills. It makes them less bored and less amortized by this daily work along the years. Now, the idea is how you can transfer these ideas to larger scales, to a city, to a nation. I have no idea. I have really no idea. Perhaps everything that I have said doesn't scale. It can be done at the organizational level, but it cannot be done at the national level. Okay. I think that new techniques need to be developed, and we must add social scientists to our game. Okay. I agree with you. They are poor gunslingers, and I don't like them for this. They don't like guns. I like guns. They don't like guns. They are very poor at Kali Linux. They don't know how to spin Kali Linux like us. Okay, they're really bad. But still, we have to remember that they are the technologists of the mind, of the human spirit, and we need them in our camp, in our profession. I would like to sum up my lecture by saying that particular techniques are less important. The really important thing is to realize that the technologies we are infatuated with are only intervening variables. The main issue is not technologies impact on technology, but technologies impact on people. This is the main issue. People are the main issue. Our test at the bottom line is to defend people. And the protection of physical infrastructure is only a means, is only a means to achieve it. Yes, my call to action is this. Let's think more about flesh and blood humans, about our organizations, about our societies, about our nations. What are their vulnerabilities? What failure? What critical infrastructure makes them hurt, not function, hurt? It's a different idea. What are their most critical moral infrastructures? And last but not least, how can we leverage our technological expertise in explosives, in guns, in everything, what we like to do in order to serve and protect them? Because this is our most important task. Remembering that beyond the silicon, beyond steel, and beyond concrete, we have real people with critical moral infrastructures to protect. Thank you very much. And by the way, don't smoke this, it will kill you.